Hi everyone. I just want to talk a little bit about variation and speciation in the Homo ergaster and Homo erectus. So I'm going to do this by starting with the Homo morphology. Oops, go back. Homo morphology. These are traits that are consistent in all Homo species. Okay, so like primate traits, these are similar in that way. So all of the Homo species have larger incisors than molars, unlike the australopithecines that have the reverse. They also, at least for ergasters, have thin dental enamel, overall reduced superstructures, so a smaller face than you would see in australopithecines, encephalization, which means an increase in brain size relative to the body size, so they're getting even bigger brains. And then, of course, the cranial shape is changing because the brain is moving position. And I'll show you what that looks like. Okay, for ergaster, this species is only found in Africa. They have thin cranial bones, they have smaller superstructures in the face and the skull, and advanced postcrania, meaning from the below the skull. Larger body size and long and linear skeletons. So the first one is the KNMER 3733. This one was dated to 1.7 million years ago. It was found in Kubifor, Africa. The brain case is 850, about twice that of australopithecines. It's the first hominid to show a forehead. So this is one of the first things I want to talk to you about, is that the brain didn't just get bigger, but it changed position. So you'll see in some of these other slides, and if you remember from the australopithecines and other species, the brain case was always back here and then the face over here. So there was two parts to it with a really tight postorbital constriction around right behind the eyes. So we've got a brain that is bigger and pushing forward, creating an expansion of the occipital, of the parietal. So in australopithecines, it's like this. In ergaster, it's moving out like this, which is the shape that we see on the parietals here and here, which is something we still have today. These rounded areas are the parietal bosses, and we still have that trait now. You'll also see that the face is small, and this here is the nasal bone sticking out of the face. So for the first time, we would have had a homo species with a nose sticking out of the face and not pushed in like we saw in the australopithecines. Okay. The ergaster is the first to do a few things. Among them, the first to use fire. We have evidence of that in the archaeological record. And then also the first to leave Africa and migrate to different geographic areas around the world, basically. So I'll show you a map in a second. You can see what that looks like. But along with moving out into these other areas, they're also changing and adapting, because this move isn't like an overnight 1 month or a year. We're talking about probably several hundred years of movement throughout these areas, maybe even more than several hundred. In fact, we don't have exact dates, but I'll show you what we do have in terms of fossil record. So these are the ergasters in Africa. You can see 2.4 to about 1.9 with the, I'm not sure why Turkana isn't in here. Well, Turkana here, but the Nariocotomy boy is about 1.7 million. So 2.4 to 1.7 million. So we estimate that it may have been around 2 million that the first ergaster begins to move out of Africa and into other parts of Eurasia. So here is the Dominici, the Eastern Georgia erectus. I'll show you this one. And then they move into other areas, different parts of China, and then also way into Indonesia. So I told you, they're walking a long way. This is far. And then because these are islands, we have something specific going on here, which I'll talk to you about. Okay, so ergaster is represented also by the Nariocotomy boy, also known as WT15000. This example, and I'm going to just go straight to the picture. You can read this later if you will. So this example, this is the nariocotomy boy. You can see some lines here on the bones. These are called epiphyseal sutures. Well, they're not quite sutures, they're more like fissures. And these will close as the person gets older. This happens in our skeletons too. So as we get older, these sutures will begin to close, and then they'll make one bone rather than three, for example. Okay, so because of these sutures are pretty much all open, we know that he was a child. And because of his dentition, we know that he was about 8 years old when he died. Okay, so had he grown to adulthood, though, he would have been 6'2". I put 6 foot tall, but he would have been 6'2". And that is based on estimation of height using the femur and the tibia and even the humerus. So all of those corroborate a height of about 6'2". Meanwhile, in other parts of Eurasia, these guys are much smaller. I also want to point out that the nose is coming out here too. So just like we saw in the 37-33. Okay, here's a little range of distribution. Ergaster, whoop whoop, wins as the tallest so far at this time, at that time. And then Homo sapiens coming later. So Dominici, these little guys are still real little guys. So they're not getting much taller than about 4 feet for the most part. Now, going to erectus in Asia. So here's what's happening. Once these ergaster are moving into Eurasia, they begin to change. They are adapting to the climate, to the environment. They're also succumbing to genetic drift, which is no new gene flow. So they're only able to use the genes in their gene pool, which means they're limited in terms of variation. So these guys have thick cranial bones, large superstructures here in the brow ridge, here in the mastoid process, behind your ear. Like, these were twice the size of the bumps you feel behind your ear. And here in the cheekbones, they're just like really puffy, and that's all bone. Notice the skull. It's a bit longer than we saw in the ergasters, right? And then we still have the nose coming out a bit. But this brain is not as forward. There isn't much of a frontal lobe going on here. And to an extent, that is demonstrating the archaeological record, because they're not producing any new stone tools. But we do believe that they were focusing on bamboo, because there's not a lot of stone tools. They must have been using something. So we think in that way they were adapting culturally to the fauna that was available readily, which were, you know, hundreds of bamboo varieties. Okay. Let me see. Let's go here. Okay. Now this is the Chinese erectus. This is Chokojian. This is much, much more recent, 800,000 years. But take a look at this, because this is after genetically adapting through natural selection to the environment in China. These traits are different than the other ones. So these have become even more specifically different than the Javanese versions. So, and you see here the goniac angles that stick out here, right here, the chin, they stick out a lot. Now this becomes a trait of Asian populations, not just in China, but all throughout this region of Asia. So much so that that trait can be found in the Inuit populations in Alaska, and in that area. We can also see the goniac angles in Native American populations, because those groups came from this same area of China. Okay, so very distinctive kind of appearance. But you'll also see that the brain is pushed forward, and there's a bit of a frontal lobe here. Even though you could seriously delineate the face here and the brain case here. And in reverse of what we saw with nariocotomy in 37-33, this area of the mandible is quite massive. And this is very similar to what we saw in these some of the habilis and the australopithecines. So there's definitely something different here, right? Okay. And then, of course, this sagittal keel, which is sort of like this rounding area at the top of the skull. That's definitely a plesiomorphic or old ancestral trait from the Australopithecines. Okay, now this is one of the strangest ones. So this is the erectus in Eastern Europe. This is Dominici. And seriously, this massive brow ridge, this is not even like the San Giron from Java, right? That was two parts to the brow ridge. This is like one almost shelf. And this is so similar to what we saw in Habilis. So whatever they were coming out of Africa and moving to these other places, that look was a very primitive look with a lot of with a lot of plesiomorphic traits. There is some conjecture that maybe it wasn't even ergaster that left first, that maybe it was something different, something else. Okay, so the nose is tucked in. I mean, this is an ape-like nose like we haven't seen since like maybe even before Habilis. So this is a really different looking variety of erectus. And I'll also point out this crazy mandible. This is so different than what we see from these other species, of the other variations of erectus. So why do we see this? Okay, we see this because variation comes from adaptation to changing local environments. That's natural selection. And it's natural selection, and in this case, it's also genetic drift, because as these groups are moving into different areas, you know, you'll have stragglers, you'll have some stay behind, they like it there, somebody gets hurt, whatever, I don't know. They're staying behind, and in those areas where they're staying behind, there's no new genes coming in, but they're still reproducing. And they're reproducing only using the genes in that gene pool. So in that case, let's say that shape of the mandible belonged to one or two of the original settlers, of the original group or founders, right? That means that that trait will become dominant over time if that group continues to be small and does not get any new genes. That's what we call founder's effect. And that means that those traits will become dominant in that population. So this is why we see such differences in Africa and then in Asia between China and Java, for example. And then also with the Dominici, which is like almost a weird outlier. And that makes sense because they're adapting to those different environments, right? Okay, so that's it. I hope you got something out of that. And if you have any questions, let me know.